Hey, Pastor Steve here, and we're going to start a Bible study this week on who we are in Christ Jesus. Last week we did a little bit of a summary, but this week what we're looking at is how God sees us. You know, it's important to understand that if God sees us in a certain way, and we live our lives in the way that God knows us, then we can come to know Him in a much greater way, and we can have greater confidence in who we are in Christ Jesus. So what this Bible study will do is it's going to take us to a level where we're going to start looking at who we are in Christ Jesus. In other words, how did Christ make you? Christ made you to be a masterpiece. God made you to be His own child. God made you to be victorious. God made you a blessing to all people. He's made you to be healed. He's made you to be Christ-like. He's made you to be miraculous. All these things are true, and this is what God created you to be in Christ Jesus. Now, if God says it, then shouldn't it be true? I mean, really, if we can believe what God has said about us, can't we grow in a way that will enable us to be able to live that life that God has set aside for us? If we can do that, then we can start living that life that God wants us to live. We can start living a victorious life, and we don't have to be beat around the head by Satan. In fact, we should be beating him around the head, right? So what we want to do is we want to take a look at four different questions. And those four different questions, if we answer these properly, then we're going to start being able to start living that life that God wants us to live. And we'll talk a lot about that in just a moment. But what we want to, our first question that we want to ask is, what has God called you to be in this life? I'm sure that there's something that stimulates your thought process to say, well, I really would like to be a polo player. I mean, there's so many different things that you could want to do, but what is it that God has called you to be? You know, if you can answer that one question, then you're more than halfway there because you've already identified what it is that God's called you to be. And in fact, most Christians already know what that is. Now, we can sit here all day long and say, well, I wonder what God's will is for my life. I don't know. I can flip a coin, I guess. That's not what God wants us to do. And in fact, He's built that deep inside of your DNA. He has created you to want to do something more than anything else, because that's what His plan for you is. We'll talk a lot about that in this particular session. Now, the second question that we want to answer, if we can answer, what do you think that God's called you to be? Our next question is what does the Word of God say about that? We want to bounce that off of the Word of God. We want to look in here and we want to start finding what it is that God told us about us. He said that He's created for a very specific purpose, every one of us. And if we can find that here in the Word of God, now all of a sudden we can start following that prescription that God has set aside for us. In fact, it's a written prescription. It's right here in the Word of God. So I'm going to hopefully lead you through that process, at least to identify who you are and what the Word says that you are. And when you do that, you're going to see a huge difference in your life. And that's ultimately the goal of this entire Bible study, right? The third thing that we want to do is, what steps can you start taking to start fulfilling what it is that God has called you to be? Now, we know that miracles come to pass when we know that it's God's will and when we actually act on them. The actual essence of a miracle does not begin or does not happen until you actually take that step forward. Look, a good example of that is when the priests went across the Jordan River. That Jordan River did not part and did not open up for them until they put their feet in the water. Well, we know that that's true. So what we want to do then is we want to start moving forward, and as we do the things that God has called us to do, we're going to start seeing, wow, that really worked out, didn't it? And the more that we have confidence in that, and the more that we bounce this off of the Word of God, then we can start seeing how it is that God wants us to live our lives. And then once we take step one, we'll start taking step two. Another great example of this is Abraham. You know, Abraham is sitting there in Mesopotamia. He's doing his own thing. You know, his father was called to go to the land of Canaan. He stopped halfway because he found a really great tree to lay under. I'm serious. Read about it. But what Abraham did was God called him to leave his parents, leave his father, and move on to the land of Canaan. Abraham had no clue what to do, but he did that anyway. And when he got to the land of Canaan, then God fulfilled all of the promises. He said, now I want you to take this next step. And all the way to the end of his life, and even past beyond that, into all of his different descendants, we see that Abraham was able to fulfill the will of God in his life simply because he moved forward with what God told him to do. What's God told you to do? Are you moving forward with it? Well, that's our step. We want to identify what it is in the Word of God, then we want to start moving forward towards that. Now, the fourth thing is what is the end result? You may say, Steve, I don't know. I haven't been there yet. Now, what do you visualize this? If God said that you're going to be a pastor, then what does your church look like? If God has told you that you're going to be an encourager and that you're going to win many people to the Lord, what does that scene in heaven look like? The reason is that I'm saying this is because if you can visualize it, if you can see it, your body doesn't know the difference. Did you know that? Your body doesn't know the difference of what is real and what isn't real. It only does what your mind tells you. So if your mind is telling your body that it's true that you're a winner of souls, that you're going to lead all kinds of different people to the Lord, and it starts visualizing these things, your body doesn't know the difference, and it's not going to fight against it. It's just going to say, well, I guess that's what the deal is. And it'll actually take the steps to move forward towards what it is that God's called you to be. And we'll talk a lot more about this and how this scientific principle works, but I'll tell you that the principle that works absolutely and hands down is this principle that's right here in the Word of God. And as we look these things up, and if we start seeing these things, then all of a sudden we can start visualizing it, we start living it, and we start actually participating in the life that God has called you to be. So this week, what we want to do is we want to take a look at who God says that you are. What does the Word of God say that you are? I mean, you know, he doesn't say, well, they're wimpy people and we just can't work with that guy because his name is Steve. That's not how it works. What we want to do is we want to go through and we start looking through these verses and see, what has God called you? What has God said that you are? When we can do that, then we can start seeing the perfect plan of God's will and within our lives. So the more that we do that, the more now that we're able to start seeing ourselves as more Christ-like. We can start seeing ourselves as who God says that we are. So we're going to start out in Genesis 1:26. I encourage you to open up your Bible, read this in context, and see how this works. But Genesis 1:26 says, "Then God said, 'Let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign.'" You know, God has called you to reign. You know why? Because he created you just like himself. Just because God has a head, two arms, and two feet doesn't mean that that's the image that you're made in. The image that you're made in is the image of God in person, three parts. In other words, God, Elohim, God's three parts. That's the way that you are. You're a spirit, soul, body. You're made in his image. So you know what? If you're made like God, doesn't it make sense that you can also act like God? I know that may be a little bit wild for some of us to believe, but can't you say things that are not as though they were? Can't you walk by faith and not by sight? Can't you live a God kind of life here on this earth? Absolutely you can. But we don't think that it's possible because we've never experienced it. Well, why can't you imagine it? Why can't you see, wait a second, God created me in his image, and if God is perfect, then I'm perfect. That's not that much of a stretch. God made you perfectly formed to be able to accomplish the plan that he created you for. He did not sabotage your life. He did not say, wait a second, I'm going to make this person fail miserably, because that's not in his nature. He is absolutely victorious in everything that he does, right? God is perfect in every single way. So if you're made in his image, that would make you perfect in every single way. And that's what we need to start living our lives like. Have you ever seen those kids that are just so arrogant when they get to kindergarten? I mean, they think they're the bomb, they're the stuff, they're the ones that can do anything in this life. You know why? Because their parents tell them that they can. What if your parents told you that? What if God, your father, told you that? And he has. That you were made in his image, he doesn't make junk, so you are going to be able to accomplish every single thing he called you to. You see it? Well, I hope that you can. Turn with me to Ephesians 2:10. Check this out. It says, "For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do the good things that he's planned for us long ago." So all we have to do then is we have to realize that if Paul said that we are God's masterpiece, then guess what Paul said about you? You are God's masterpiece. So we can start saying this, and we need to start saying this. I am God's masterpiece. I can live a life of perfection. I can live a life of what God has called me to be, because I am absolutely perfectly and wonderfully made. We're going to cover that in just a second. But if you're God's masterpiece, it doesn't mean you're a Picasso with one eye up here and, you know, your tongue down here and an ear over here and a foot there sticking out of your face. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about an exquisitely crafted, perfectly made masterpiece of himself. Now, if God were to make a masterpiece of himself, or including the last scripture with us, wouldn't he try and make that perfect? Well, you're the masterpiece of himself here on this earth, so then you should be perfect in every single way. We need to start living our lives like this, And the way that we can do this is by starting to proclaim it. So let's proclaim that right now. I am God's masterpiece. Can you say that? Amen. I agree with you. You are God's masterpiece. Turn with me to Psalms 139, verse 14. Psalms 139 says, "Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it." Now, this is important because in the King James, it tells us that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. If you are fearfully and wonderfully made, if you're wonderfully complex, then God has created you as His masterpiece. God has made you in a way that is absolutely perfect. He's not just talking about Steve. Now, I know that I'm wonderful, but you're wonderful too. Every single person watching this video is wonderful. Even some of the people not watching it are wonderful. God created us to be wonderful because we are His workmanship. God, again, did not make any junk. He made you perfectly and well-formed. Just because you have a sickness or just because you have something that doesn't line up with that, it doesn't mean that it's true. Remember what I said. Our bodies don't know the difference of what's going on in this world and what our mind tells it to believe. So why not proclaim right now that I am wonderfully made, that I am fearfully and wonderfully made? Go ahead and say it. That's right, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. So God has created us for a very specific purpose, and I want you to see this because when God said, "Light be," He created light within the universe. But we don't see the sun, stars, moon, or anything else created until the third day. So how does that work? Well, what God did was He created light photons. You may say, "Okay, Steve, that's a little bit out there," but I want you to understand something. Every single thing in this universe has been made out of light photons. So God had to lay out all of the craftsmanship, all the things that He was going to make this world out of. He had to lay it out there first. All he was doing was opening up His toolbox. When He said light be, He created light photons. So why is that important? Well, there's some very important experiments that we want to follow because they use light photons to demonstrate the power of how wonderfully and complex you were made. Now, this first experiment was conducted in 1995. And this experiment, what it did was they took a vacuum, or they took a glass vial, and they created a vacuum. They pumped all of the air out of it so that the only thing that was left inside of this glass vacuum were light photons. So within these light photons, they were completely erratic. They were all over the inside of this jar. They weren't piled up on the bottom. They weren't on the top. They weren't bouncing off the walls. They weren't in one place all clumped together. They were absolutely randomly spaced throughout this entire vacuum. So what they did was they took some human DNA. They took that one strand of human DNA and they put that into that vacuum. And you know how the light photons affected that DNA? They didn't. That DNA affected those light photons. Those light photons came together and they formed themselves around that DNA. Now check this out. They formed the exact replica of that DNA because that DNA was there. If that DNA was not there, those light photons wouldn't have done anything. What does that say about our role in the universe? Well, obviously our DNA can actually manipulate light photons. Doesn't that mean that we can say things that are not as though they are? That's how God created the universe out of these light photons. You can't see a light photon, but you can see the things that it makes. I mean, I'm standing right here. This table right here is actually made out of light photons. You are made out of light photons, and our DNA can actually manipulate it. So here's a really beautiful thing. When that DNA was extracted, what happened to the light photons? They stayed together. To their surprise, the scientists couldn't believe it, but they saw this. Now, this is all put forward in a magazine called Nanobiology, and it was published in 1995. So it's a scientific peer-reviewed article that has been proven to be true. And if you can replicate these types of experiments, then we can see that human DNA was actually formed by God to actually change light photons into the things that are out there. And in fact, God changed the light photons in the very same way, right? When He said light be, and then He spoke the rest of creation into existence as well. So there's another experiment that I want to explain to you that shows you that we are fearfully and wonderfully made and that we have a purpose. So umbilical DNA, it's perfect DNA. A baby was born, they took the DNA that was there in the umbilical cord and they sealed it. They put it in a double glass vial that was also vacuum sealed. So there's nothing that can influence this DNA. And what they did was they brought it in and they put it right in front of a person who was good at controlling their emotions. And the first thing they did was they said, I want you to hate that DNA. I want you to hate that file. I want you to curse it. I want you to hold all kinds of unforgiveness against it. I want you to act in the flesh, so to speak. That's the way that we Christians would call it. And you know what happened? That DNA crumpled up as if it were dying. And it completely disintegrated and fell apart. All because of those negative words that were spoken. And it was not coming from here or even from here. It was coming from the force of the heart. Because the heart actually has a greater electromagnetic charge than any other part of our body. And that's what actually affected that DNA in a negative way. So they got another strand of DNA. And they put it in a vial. And you can see where I'm going with this. And what they did was they took it. And this person now spoke love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, forgiveness, all the things of the fruit of the Spirit. And as they spoke those things to that DNA, you know what happened? It didn't just stay the same. What it did was it flattened out, it began to pull apart, and began replicating itself. The very idea that human DNA can be changed by someone else speaks to the way that we should be speaking to others, that we should feel about others. Because I don't have to say a word, but if I'm within 5 or 6 feet of you, I can actually control your DNA by the way that I think about you and the way that my heart does that. Now, you can do the same thing to me. So, for example, if I were to smile at you, you're going to smile back at me. If I'm laughing and having a good time, in most cases, you're going to say to yourself, wow, I think that that's kind of funny too. And then you join me in that, and what's happening is that you're replicating perfect human DNA. And this is how God designed us to be. He didn't create us to be apart from each other. In fact, He encouraged us to encourage others. When God encourages you, your DNA is flattening out and reproducing itself in a positive way. And that's what we want to do. Now, this was also published in a peer-reviewed article in 1994 in the Journal of Scientific Exploration. So this is absolutely true. And we're going to spend a lot more time looking at the double slit experiment when we talk about creation and how God did all of these things and how we're here to observe God's perfect creation. And in fact, we've got to be here for a purpose, and it should be to be able to do what God called us to do. So now, if God called us to do this, check this out. By my emotions, I can control the creation of DNA. I can also destroy DNA. That DNA also has the ability, based off of the first experiment, to actually go out and to change matter. So if DNA can change matter, and if I can change DNA with my thought process, what does that say about the way that I look at myself? If I look positively at the way that God created me, then all of a sudden, I can start believing all of these things. And it starts with my mouth. As I begin to speak these things and I start to proclaim the things that God says about me, my mind is going to start believing it. And as I'm speaking it and as my mind is believing it, my body is going to follow right along. So check this out. This is Ephesians 1:18. It says that I pray your hearts be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope that He's given to us, those who He's called. Now that's important because that part of the verse tells us that we can actually call on our hearts to be flooded with light. Remember what I said the most powerful organ in our body is? It's our heart. What did I say about light photons? If light photons are in our heart and then they're manipulated or changed or created by the emotions that we feel right here, can't I create things? I can create hope. I can create positive influences. I can create matter. I mean, these are all things that God created us to be able to do here on this earth because He wants us to be like He is. Okay? It doesn't mean that I'm replacing God, and I'm not like Satan where I'm saying, well, I'm going to take God's place. Uh-uh. God's the Father. He's in charge of all of this. He's the one that makes all of this possible. All I want to do is I want to live the life that God intended for me. Now I can do that. Now the second part of this verse says that He has given hope to those that He has called. So this works only for us Christians, but also that we're His holy people, we're His rich and His glorious inheritance. The God who created the entire universe, the God who created all things, sees you as more valuable than anything that He's created. That includes Jupiter and its moon that's raining diamonds. I mean, that includes all the gold in the entire galaxy. I mean, all the things that God has created, out of all of them, you are His glorious inheritance. That's why He sent Jesus to die on the cross for your sins. So we have to believe that God's got a purpose for you, and that's absolutely what God created you for. Turn with me to Deuteronomy 7:6 and look at this. It says, "For you are his holy people who belong to the Lord your God. Out of all the people on the earth, the Lord your God has chosen you to be his special treasure." So not only are you his great inheritance, his glorious inheritance, you're also his special treasure. Not only has he created you for an outstanding purpose and made you in his image, you are his special treasure. God holds you special in his heart. He's not going to change his mind. He's not going to say, "No way, you know, I just don't care about that anymore." He's not going to sell you at a yard sale. He's not going to cast you into the closet. He's not going to put you into a box and hide you in the attic. He's not going to do any of those things. He's going to carry you deeply, caringly in his hand and in his arms because he loves you more than anything in this world. You know, John 3:16 tells us this. In the CEV, it says, "God loved the people of this world so much that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who has faith in him will have eternal life and never really die." Isn't that a great promise? God has told us that, you know, if we simply believe in him with a God kind of faith, then he is going to love us with a God kind of love, and that he's going to give us a God kind of life on this earth. So really, John 3:16 tells us that a God kind of love produces a God kind of faith, which produces a God kind of love, life. That God kind of life is a Zoe kind of life. That's literally the way that God would live here on this earth. You can do that. You have the ability to be able to live like God on this earth. Do you think that God would have cancer? No. So you can overcome cancer if you start realizing this. Okay, your body is designed wonderfully and perfectly made. The ability to be able to stop a virus in its tracks is absolutely within your DNA. Not many people believe that nowadays, but the reality is that you were created to overcome viruses. You were created to overcome cancer. You were created to overcome any difficulty that's in this life. Now, just because you're in difficulty right now, you may be sitting here homeless. You might not have any place to go, but I want you to understand this very point, that God's will has not ended just because things don't seem to be going well. What happens when you get to the other side of this difficulty in this trial and you see that God carried you through it? You see that because God said that, wait a second, that's my special treasure. I'm going to lift it out of the dung heap and I'm going to take care of it. I'm going to polish it up a little bit and I'm going to put it on my mantle. I'm going to put it in my pocket. I'm going to bring it with me everywhere I go. I'm going to show it off because it is my special creation. God loves you that much that he sent his son for you. And this is a very popular verse. I encourage you to memorize it, state it. Say, wait a second, God loves me so much that he sent his son. Go ahead and say it. It's true. The next verse that I want you to open up to is 1 John 4:10 and 11. It says this. This is real love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us that much, we surely ought to love each other. Can't we love each other because God loves us? Now, a lot of us will get this wrong. Well, if I just love God a little bit more, if I just do a little bit more, if I just kind of turn into him a little bit, if I start loving him, then he'll love me back. Well, that's the earthly kind of love. A godly kind of love means that God loves you because you're you. And if God loves you because you're you, then there's nothing that you can do to change his mind about that. Now, that's got to be huge in our own lives as we start reading through the Word of God and we start realizing that, wait a second, God loves me that much. I don't have to do anything to earn his love. You don't have to do anything to earn his love. When you start looking at it that way, then you can start loving others the way that God loves them. Now, look at the way that that will change, because now all of a sudden, can't you forgive somebody if you love them as much as God loves them? Now, it seems impossible for us as humans to be able to live a life like that. But God wants you to be able to do your best to be able to live like that so that you can forgive like he forgives, so that you can love like he loves. It'll absolutely change your perspective on life if you start looking at people as, wait a second, I can't hate that guy because, well, God loves them even more than they love themselves. So we can overcome hate, we can overcome unforgiveness if we start loving others the way that God has loved us. So can't we say that? Can't we say, God loves me so much that I want to love others the same way, right? In fact, if we can say it in a positive way, we can say, God loves me so much and that I love others the same way that God loves them. Now, it may not be true initially, but the more that you say it, the more you're going to start seeing it happen, more of it coming to pass. Jeremiah 1:5 says this, that God knew you before he formed you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, he set you apart. He's appointed you as his prophet to the nations. Now, you're appointed. You might not be appointed to be a prophet, but you might be appointed to be a teacher. You might not be appointed to be a prophet, but you might be appointed to be a prayer warrior. You might not be appointed a prophet, but you might be appointed to be a faith person. You know, what God has appointed you for, you can't ignore. If you just simply step out in it, you're going to start seeing that the more that you start operating in the gifts and the talents that God has given you, the more you're going to start operating in the way that God has appointed you. So why not say it? I'm appointed to be a teacher. That's me. What has God appointed you to be? Say it. I dare you. I double dog dare you, because it's going to come to pass. Jeremiah 29:11 says this. Now, this is in the Message translation. I like the translation. It says, I know what I'm doing. I have it all planned out. Plans to take care of you, not to abandon you. Plans to give you a future and something to hope for. God himself has got a plan for you. And you know what? That plan was from before the beginning of the world. If God had a plan for you from before the beginning of the world, what on earth do you think you could do in this life to change that plan that God, who never changes, already made for you? Nothing. And God's plan isn't to harm you. It isn't to hurt you. It isn't to do anything. So if we start operating in God's plan, then we start seeing the Abraham type of results. Abraham had tremendous results. We think, well, he was just lucky. Well, he had a one-on-one relationship with God. God sent his son, Jesus Christ, so that you could have an even better relationship with him than Abraham did. And you know that that's true. So your relationship can foster and it can grow to be as great as Abraham's was. So why not say it? Wait a second, God's got a plan for me, and it is not over yet. Okay, so we can live that. We can start doing that. Why don't we start believing it? Psalms 139, 17 and 18 says this, how precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you are still with me. God's promise is that he's never going to leave us. He's never going to forsake us. But think about this. If God is thinking about you this very moment, you watching this video, you thinking about what it is that you're going to do tomorrow, all these plans that you have, all these things that you're doing right now, even if you're embroiled in sin, you know what? God is thinking about you. God's thoughts are on you every single day. Now, there's only one way that that's possible. That's if he is God. Well, he is God, and he's able to keep all his thoughts on you. So think about this, and in fact, proclaim this. Go ahead and say it. God's thoughts are on me, and they're good, and they're perfect.